right at the audience. When Ramjas College invited me for this TED talk with the theme Catalyst, I thought Catalyst is the best theme ever for talking to the young audience, for the youngsters, because you yourself are the determined achievers in your own way. And Catalyst for me, being a chemistry student in my own college time, I would say Catalyst I understand as the one which brings changes, which brings acceleration, essentially, to an already happening reaction, to an already existing phenomena, it brings acceleration. So with that as a theme, I bring you the dream that has been mine, that I am living today as an army officer and as an Everester, and to tell you that you have your own dreams and your own dream is your catalyst. Ladies and gentlemen, when I reached on the summit of Mount Everest on 26th May 2012, I actually saw the sunrise from the top of the world. I'm one of those few people in the world who have seen a bright orange sun warming up to the earth. And in front of me, I had the Tibetan plateau on the eastern side, completely submerged in the clouds. It was typically that scene which comes from those Indian series, the paradise scene. And beyond that was that sun. And this was my moment that gives me the mark in my life. I just can't explain more of that. That whatever hard work, in our language we say ghume todna, whatever things we had put in for last more than 1 year for preparing for Everest, that had come to a conclusion. When we reached the summit, this photograph was taken much after the sun was effective, and much after we had actually settled with the idea that we have reached the summit. So this is the way the Tibetan plateau looked like. This is the way the northern ridge of the Everest was, the Nepal. And this, ladies and gentlemen, is the best photograph of my life. Mount Everest is somewhere here in Nepal, at the border of Nepal and Tibet. Before we go to the Mount Everest, let's talk about something which was the driving force for me or for anyone in my team. You see, army was my childhood dream. I was born with that dream, they say, because I never thought of anything other than army as my career. And I'm that person who's living my dream. I became an army officer at the age of 20. And at the age of 20, I was already holding weapons. I was already at the China border. My first posting was at the China border. My second posting was at the Punjab border. I have done Siachen 4 times. In 2002 I got commissioned. In 2009, I got my opportunity to go to Siachen for the first time. And anybody who has ever held an ice axe in their hand has dreamt of Mount Everest. Like any one of you who is studying in classes has dreamt of topping the class. Anybody who is a politician has dreamt of becoming the PM of the country once. Anybody who is an actor has dreamt of having an Oscar. So when I held the ice axe, I was in Siachen already. I was experiencing the cold for the very first time, the glacier cold for the very first time, and holding the ice axe, and already in the highest battlefield in the world. I tell you, ladies and gentlemen, 2009 was the year we were celebrating the 10th anniversary of Operation Vijay. We know about Operation Vijay, do we? Operation Vijay was the famous Kargil War in 1999. And we wanted to make a statement to the world that we have this plan. So ladies and gentlemen, we had this operational expedition at Siachen. On 15th of August, we had reached to the spine of Siachen Glacier. Siachen Glacier. On 15th August 2009, I stood there with my team, and at 7:20 a.m., we sang the national anthem. We looked at Pakistan, we looked at China, we looked into India. I have one photograph here for you. This is the way India looks like from the northernmost known geographical point of India. So I till date have goosebumps when I remember that moment of my life. Army gave me that one moment which defined me for the rest of my life. This is what I wanted to do. This is the reason I joined the army. I'm actually one of those people, or many in the army are those people who have seen the Pakistani posts and them holding huge black flags in the morning and we holding huge national flags. This is the way Indira Hall looked like when we were standing there with our big national flag. So that one moment was such a defining moment for me. That came much after I had joined the army. I joined the army in 2002 and I had this one moment in 2009. But that does not mean that I did not have my moments in army. I had all of them. I've had a huge and big time contentment, satisfaction in the army. So this was my fuel. The dream is the fuel. This was my fuel for the Everest, my start point for my Everest dream. So with this I started in 2009, and after that we trained and trained and trained, and in 2011 we had started our formal training for the Mount Everest in 2012. It took us 1 year. Why? Because Indian Army puts in tremendous amount of effort in creating a legacy. It's not an overstatement, ladies and gentlemen, that Indian Army leads the scene when it comes to sports and adventure, and specifically when it comes to mountaineering. And that is because, in, for example, in our team, we had some legends like Jalal, Rambabu Jalal, like R.S. Jamwal, who are three times Everesters, who have done many more mountains, 8,000ers and all. We had some moderately experienced, at that time I was considered moderately experienced, and we had some who were absolute novices. So with that kind of a team, we had started, and with novices and with legends, we were training, and that's how we had to put in that much of time. So I'll show you some photos of the training that we had. This is a kind of rock walls and ice walls we were climbing as part of our training. And mind you, this was all in Siachen area. So four times Siachen was, twice was for mountaineering trainings, but three months full tenures, and twice was for combat deployments for me. So this is the way we looked like when we were climbing these ice walls. These are proper mountain ice walls. If we had more time, I would probably tell you about how glaciers react and what glaciers are when they when you are there and when they greet you and treat you in the mountains. Our survival techniques are not really within the scope of this. But the one thing that we have in army and in mountaineering per se is that we are very close to nature. Is that we get to see the best of it. The 1100 camels, I don't think anybody of any average delight has seen them. So, dreams and how they drive you, how they take you. My dream took me to the army, my dream took me to Everest. This photograph, which you see on the viewfile right now, is of a Nepalese team of girls. When we went there in Nepal and Kathmandu, we met this team. These girls, in 2008, they came from that small little remote country of Nepal. They came from villages of that country. So many of them had just thought that we'll do it. Having 10 rupees in their pocket, they just took the bus and to Kathmandu and reached there. 10 of them got together, thought that we'll do Everest. No money, no resources, no training, no equipment. Absolutely no support. So what they decided was that they started working as tourist guides, trekking guides. And how much money they raised for themselves. without having any sponsors, without having any training themselves. 2 crore Nepalese rupees. That was the kind of money these 10 girls raised for themselves. Then they trained themselves, and then they took all the second-hand equipment and went on to do Everest. And in 2008, these girls actually did Everest. Now when you Google them, you will find them as 7 summit Nepalese girls. So how many times we think that our resources are less, meager? My dream is too outrageous. Oh my God, how can I be this? No, you can be anything. You can be anything as you think. You can be anything that you want to. The only thing is that there is no shortcut to it. There is no substitute to hard work. You have to go the distance. Your dream is your fuel. Your dream is your catalyst. It will bring you reaction. It will bring you acceleration. But you have to put in the substance. You have to put in your hard work. There will be no substitute to that, but you can always achieve anything as you want. We also had, I have had the fortunate opportunities of meeting so many people, but Bhatindri Pal, the first Everester, the first woman Everester of India, she tops the list. Let me tell you, ladies and gentlemen, Bhatindri Pal is a lady. She did Everest in 84, first woman to do Everest in India. And since then, she has dedicated her life into encouraging the youth into outdoor leadership. She goes to Everest every year. She has done Trans Himalaya. She has done desert safaris, whatnot. But what is that one great credit she has about being the first Everester in India? That is that she came from a very little village in Uttaranchal, today's Uttaranchal, yesteryear's Uttar Pradesh. And then she has to actually go through the entire process of fighting her society, her family, her village. In her Pahadi village, nobody understood even this much that why do you have to climb mountains? Go somewhere else to climb mountains. Climb mountain in your own village. Come here, in your next mohalla, there is a mountain. So to bring that concept that no, a girl not just get married and have children, in that era, in the early 80s village of Uttar Pradesh, she thought and she had that drive that I will do it on my own and I will do it. She used to carry her backpacks with stones on her back, in her backpack, to do the low training and climb her local mountains. And she was never confident that she will be actually able to make it to the Everest by such kind of training. Eventually she did, and eventually she is the name in our history. But she again is that example available to us that your dream is the only thing that can bring you your own change, that can bring your own society your change, the change that you want to see, the change that you want to see in your life. Another Everester, another friend of mine, Arunima Sinha, who all know about Arunima Sinha. Wonderful. So Arunima Sinha, this lady, she did Everest in 2013, 1 year after we did. This lady had lost her leg in one of the train accidents. She was condemned. She was a national volleyball player. And then she was condemned to a bed that she will live like this probably. A poor soul, bichari ladki. That lady decided that I will do something, and I will do something to do with my legs. I will not be confined to this pity, this sympathy which I am getting from the world. So she, the day she gets discharged from the hospital, she doesn't go back to her home. She goes to Bhatindri Pal. She tells her that I want to be trained for Everest. And she trains with her for 2 years with her prosthetic leg and whatever extra equipment she needed to carry for herself. We were carrying more than 15 kgs of weight every day. I can only imagine how much Arunima was carrying with her prosthetic leg and with her essential equipment. So she actually went on and climbed the Mount Everest in 2013, and now she has climbed already 6 other peaks, the highest peaks of 6 continents in the world, and she is already off to Alaska for winter massive. So it's only and only your decision what you want to be and what you want to do with your life. and with your dreams, more importantly. It's strictly and only your decision. Nothing can ever stop you. No accident can stop you. No circumstance can stop you. No lack of resource, lack of money, lack of training, lack of encouragement, lack of support can stop you if you decide to walk that path. But remember, at the cost of repetition, I say, ladies and gentlemen, there is no substitute to hard work. You have to go the distance. Your own Prime Minister, he became Prime Minister from a Chaiwala. But he did not become Prime Minister directly from a Chaiwala. He had to go through his journey. He became something else from a Chaiwala, and then something else, and then something else. He had a huge journey of life behind him before he became the Prime Minister of India. So you have to be willing to go through that journey, and nothing can stop you. So to show you some photographs to interest you into some adventure activities, the things that bring you the josh, the adrenaline, the rush, that the rush is one thing, let me tell you. It also brings you calm. When you see the mountain ranges from a distance, this was the first view of Everest that we had when we were going through our path for Everest. And it also brings you some very special moments at the base camp, the Global Village. I'll just take you quickly through it because my time is getting over. These photos are the epitome of the kind of difficulties that we had. We had avalanches, we had the deaths, we had accidents. In one single night of one failed attempt on Everest, in one single night, these were the claims. 10 fatal casualties, 45 cases of frostbite, snow blindness, 18 cases of priority 1 evacuation in one single night. This is not about the entire expedition. Yes, this can happen. But this did not halt us. We went again. We had another summit attempt, and we actually summited during that summit attempt. Ladies and gentlemen, to bring some achievement in your own team, for me, I was one of the team leaders. So to see my entire team on the top of Everest after this much of hard work, 3 years almost, and one full year with this team itself, and having capsules in Siachen, then Manali, then some part of Siachen further, I wish you knew the names, Karakorams and Santoro areas. We had trained tremendously. We were one of the best and one of the strongest teams there. But still, there always remains a factor of uncertainty, a factor that nature is grand and nature is upon us. Mountains are just like life. It cuts you to size. Every kind of racism, sexism, or any kind of arrogance that you have. Okay, I'm an army officer, I'm so strong. Okay, I'm a man, I'm so strong. I'm taller, I'm stronger, I'm faster. Any kind of arrogance that we have, we are humbled by the nature, because there, at the Everest, nothing actually matters. If I'm 1 inch taller than you, or maybe stronger than you, it doesn't matter. An avalanche will come, it will take us both, it will kill us both. It may so happen that the person who is seemingly weaker might actually go on to summit, and the person who is seemingly stronger might actually not. So it doesn't actually matter. When you are there in the mountains, you realize that it is just like life. It is the journey which is more important, and it is the go, it is the will, it is the determination which is more important. We are all here with the same aim. It doesn't matter who reaches first, who reaches second. We are all here with the same enthusiasm, same feelings, same emotions for the Everest, and we are all looking at the similar kind of difficulties, similar paths to go, with just a different kind of experience for all of us. So it also teaches us tremendous amount of things. And the best thing that it brings us is the realization. The realization that when you reach there at the summit, you feel happy. Later, you feel blank first. You feel like you're stunned. You have achieved your dream, but what now? What now? You have to dream another dream. Otherwise, your life is over. So, ladies and gentlemen, be your own catalyst. Bring your own changes. Bring your own strength to your teams. And have your moments. Anything that you wish you can achieve, anything that you think can happen, only if you bring strength to it, only if you bring your fuel to it, your dream to it.
I have no words to express my gratitude.